Does Dr. Allen attend chapel? Does anybody know? Is he here? Oh, yeah. You know, when you ask a professor to come preach in your church as a pastor, you would think, right, they'd be gracious, kind, considerate, and really grateful because you're giving them some nice money. But apparently that's not true for everyone, because Dr. Allen started off his sermon and he made the statement in my church. He said, Chris is really doing well in the PhD. He has a solid C-minus average. So, and I had to explain to them, that's okay because he's never read anything I've written, so I don't know if he really knows that or not. I did send in my first chapter to him on my dissertation. I get it back. The footnotes, of course, he slaughtered. There's not a word about the content. So I found to email him back and go, Doctor, and what about the content? It's okay. You've got to love professors because God does, and I'm not sure why. So when I was a kid, grew up all over the South, but when I was 9 years old, I lived in Georgia, and my dad would come home and he'd say, listen, we're going to go to a particular restaurant, and man, loved the restaurant. Now, remember, when you're nine, you're not loving a restaurant because of the cuisine. At nine, if you get offered a Ruth Chris ribeye and a corn dog with mustard, you're taking the corn dog. So you're not going there because of the cuisine. But what I did love about it was when you finished the meal, they had three boxes. They were age graded. And you open up the box based on your age, and inside the box were a number of toys. And you could pick out whatever toy you wanted. And so obviously what any kid would do, what is really, and this is a key point here, what is human nature, is I'm going to reach in and take the toy that I like, that I understand and that I like and that I want to have. That's what I'm picking out of the box. Now, you have a difficult assignment. Paul told Timothy twice in the first letter, he said, I want you to guard the deposit given to you. Now, we know that was what he taught him, and in the Old Testament, we have on our theology, our theological perspective, we have all 66 books in the deposit. So we have this as our deposit. So when you come to preach each Sunday, you open up a box with 66 books in it. Now, you have two ways to handle those 66 books. One is you can reach in, pull a book out, flip through to a passage you like, and do all the text-driven work you can, and you will preach truth. But the problem with that is the danger that I see today in a new subtle temptation. When I first entered the ministry, again, before any of you were born, and I appreciate that statement made about me, but when I first entered the ministry, there were really only two major temptations in a pastor's life. It was money and sex. But there's a third for you today, and if you failed in the money and you failed in the physical intimacy, you were generally disqualified. Now, there is a third today that if you fail in, you're not DQ'd, can even be known as a great preacher. The third temptation that I've begun to see that is creeping up now, and that particular young pastors are struggling with, is a temptation between attendance and truth. That is a struggle. And the only way, I'm telling you, I'm like you, older, but like you. If I open up that box and I pull out the book of Ephesians and I'm just going to flip through it, I'm going to find what I like and what I think my church will like. I will not read those passages that I don't really like because they're negative and they're not positive and that I know my church is going to struggle with. I pastor in an area USA News and World Report said we were the third highest per capita PhDs in the country. So I pastor in an academic world. I understand what they think and what they feel. And so the only way to make sure you preach the entire truth of God, not just picking up what you like and don't like, you've got to take a book of the Bible. You've got to start in the first chapter and you've got to walk all the way through. It's the only way you'll really preach every single thing in there. And the great beauty is, it is what we would deem the negative, difficult, not positive passages that clarify and bring passion to the positive passages. So we're going to look at that today. I want you to go with me to Ephesians 2. Open up your Bibles. If you didn't bring your Bibles, we're going to send you over to Perkins. Just kidding. I don't want any emails.
We love the Methodist.
I don't want any emails. Now, when you come to Ephesians 2, the first three verses are not what most guys are going to preach. They are, in fact, painful. Part of them we would go with, but part of them in academic community in particular, and a lot of people today coming up are really just going to despise. Now, we're going to walk through the text together and listen to what he says. And you being dead in trespasses in your trespasses and in your sins. Now, when you read the word death in the scripture, you have got to explain that. Because nearly everybody, when they think of death in your church, think of a ceasing to exist. You've gone away, you've departed. We understand that is not the teaching of death in the Bible. In the Bible, when Adam and Eve sinned, they didn't cease to exist, but they lost God. That relationship is gone. They lost each other. Suddenly they're unclothed and it bothers them. They've lost each other. They lost themselves. It's the first time in their life they felt shame. And as they leave, they're going to feel frustration, guilt, and anger. And if you do not think they blistered each other over whose fault and who made the wrong decision, you're wrong. That's human nature. They tore each other up. They experience that now. And they live in a world that's broken. And that will, in fact, sting them. They will discover that with the birth of two sons, one of whom will kill the other. So death. And when you make that statement to a modern culture, they're not really that problematic with it because they see all the junk going on in America. They go, yeah, we are broken. I get that. But they hate the next statement. You're dead in your trespasses and in your sins. Now, I love first-year Greek students. They always know two words, agape and hamartia. Now, these two words here, basically, one is the ideas of sin of commission. The other is the idea of sin of omission. And so what he's saying is you're dead and you're broken and you've lost everything and you need to understand it's your fault. It's your rebellion against the Creator that has created your death. It's not a mistake. It's not that you misspoke. It's not that you had a bad day. You're not a victim. You're dead and it's your fault. They don't want to hear that statement. But that's it. You're dead, and it's your bad. That's what he says. And then look at this. In which you once walked, now listen to this, because we're going to walk through this phrase by phrase, based on the age of this world. It's a unique little phrase that refers to your culture. That before Christ, you were controlled, your beliefs and your actions, by your culture. When I was junior high, we were living in Colorado. And a young guy in the school, Martin Thiel, called me and he said, listen, Dad wants to take us the race car. And we had these little race cars you'd race inside. And so I went with him and his dad, but the whole night I was uneasy, as all of us were in school, because there was something about Martin that was distinct from every other person in the school, and we all struggled, and we were all uneasy. And the distinction was that he was the only kid in our school whose parents were divorced. There wasn't a single other kid, because in that day, the culture, their mores, their belief system was that you stayed married no matter what. Even Hollywood in that day, when they would divorce, it was a mini scandal. And so the idea was, it doesn't matter how bad it is, you stay in the marriage. And so people stayed in marriages because the culture pushed them that way. Now, you fast forward to today, it's the opposite. We're in a day where if you want to divorce, you just divorce. You're having a bad time in your home, you get out. That's our culture today. As a matter of fact, I've noticed among my college students, we're making a huge shift now, and the shift is, why marry at all? You don't know what's going to happen in 20, 21 years. You may have a struggle, you may have an issue, your child may die, you may struggle together, you fall out of love, and let's not have any legal entanglements. So let's just pack out. We're fast moving to the place where the only people that are going to enact a covenant marriage are those of us that know Jesus Christ. My kids are living together constantly because they really do view that as a high moral thing, because they're checking to see if they can make it before they marry. So our culture is driving our youth struggle today. Even those who would read the Bible and believe it struggle with same-sex issues, because the culture has said to them, look, it's legit, the Bible's wrong, and our kids are following to that. So the culture drives what we believe and think, whether we understand that or not. Now, the academics in my town are never going to accept that, because they believe they're above the culture and their intellectual ability. But most of my people are going to go, yeah, I understand that. I do kind of lean. I get that. But the next phrase, they're going to hate. That culture is driven according to the ruler of the authority there, and in case you miss who that is, of the spirit now working in the sons of disobedience, in which we all once walked, in the lust of our flesh, doing the wills of the flesh and its desires. He says the culture is controlled by Satan, God's absolute enemy. Now, your people aren't going to buy that because they don't believe he's real. But the scripture's clear. We're dead because of our rebellion. Our culture drives what we believe, and the enemy drives the culture's belief. Now, somebody's going to look at me and say, well, how can you say that? Because when you grew up, the culture belief was you stayed in a marriage until the end, and that is exactly what the Bible says. Now, that's the beauty of Satan. He always gives a little truth with an absolute failure. It's not what the Bible teaches. It is, unfortunately, what in my day and age the church was driven by. Because when I came up, if anybody was divorced, they had just completely failed in who they were. So much so that if I had somebody in my church that was divorced, my assumption is they weren't godly. And God broke me of that. I was in my first church and I had a lady call me and she said, I want you to talk to my husband and I. He wants to leave me. And they had two little girls, 4 and 2. And so she came into my office with her husband and sat down, and she just began to weep, and she said, he wants to go. And I looked over at him, and he looked at me, and he said, look, man, I don't want to be in here. I don't like you. I don't believe in Jesus. I don't want to be here. Let me tell you something about her. She's the perfect wife. She's the perfect mother. She's the perfect friend. She's a great daughter to her parents. She's moral. She's holy. I could trust her anytime I leave town. I still want to be here. And he left, which gave me the understanding that there are people being divorced and it's not at all their fault. And so I began to realize this thing of just staying together is not the issue. And it's not. Because about that time, James Dobson came along and focused on the family, and he began to teach us that what the Bible teaches isn't that we just stay together, but that inside a home with disparate personalities, different ideas, different backgrounds, all those things, you build a home that reflects the person of Jesus Christ. You build a home that reflects the fact that you're the bride of he, and you make sure your home reflects his character, so that when people see what you have, they see Christ. That's the purpose of God in a home. not just that you stay together no matter how bad it is. So the enemy does control the culture, and he does it in a brilliant way. And here's the problem, because your people are going to hate this. And we have become by nature children of wrath, as even the remaining. Now, there are a couple of Greek words in the New Testament for anger. One of them is thumos. I've seen it on the golf course, people throwing golf clubs. I've never personally done that, but I've heard rumors to that effect. That's a lie. So it means a momentary expression of anger. But this Greek word, orgēs, is the idea of an anger that has settled and has stopped and isn't going away. So here's what Paul just told you. You're dead. You're broken in four areas. It's your fault. You're controlled by your culture, which is controlled by Satan. And the end result of that is you are living under the wrath of the holy God you're in rebellion with. Now, that is not a passage most of us would preach, because it's negative, it's hard, it's not theologically acceptable by our culture. But the next few verses cannot be properly understood unless you grasp those three. Now we have this great adversative conjunction. But God. See, everything in 1 through 3 has been about you. You're dead. Your fault. You're controlled by the culture, which is controlled by Satan. You're filled with wrath. But now we're going to talk about God. But God, look at this, being rich in mercy. That's a shock. You mean I'm under his wrath, but he's rich in mercy to me? I can understand that now passionately in a way I could never understand it without understanding 1 through 3. Matter of fact, if you don't go through 1 through 3, a lot of your people in your church will go, yeah, sure, he's merciful because I'm really a good guy. I love my wife. I pay my taxes. I haven't cheated anybody. Yeah, I get mad once in a while on the road, but I'm really a pretty good guy. And they're going to assume that God's mercy is something that they really deserve, because even though they've sinned some, they're really pretty good people. So you've got to let them know, no, you're not. They've got to understand that absolutely they're not good people, but that's okay, because God is rich in mercy. Well, why would he have that richness of mercy? Look at this. He tells you two things about God's love. Because of his great love, that is innately he loves, by which he has loved us, and he has taken that love he possesses and he has put it toward us, and that's why he shows mercy. Because he loves us in spite of the fact. So now I've got this theological perfect picture that I'm under the wrath of God, but that he loves me. That there's God's holiness in this passage and God's absolute loving compassion in this passage. I have this perfect balance that I can't get without reading verses 1 through 3. And then he says, and he, when we were dead in our sins, he made us alive together with Christ. Now I can explain what that means. That number one, now that I've come to Christ and his rich mercy because of his love has fallen into my life, now my relationship with the Father is restored. Romans 8, we say, Abba, Father, and his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. So I have this great personal relationship that has been restored in the mercy and the grace of Jesus Christ. I can now, for the first time in my life, because of the indwelling of the Spirit and his power, I'm able to forgive people because I understand my own forgiveness. Thirdly, my brokenness is shattered because I understand that he has totally and completely forgiven me. I can stand on the word and lose the guilt and lose the shame and lose the embarrassment and lose the frustration because I know he's forgiven me. You say, yeah, but the world's still bad. It is bad, and it'll bite us. But you have Romans 8, 26 to 28, which says that when you don't even know how to pray, that the Holy Spirit in you prays for you. And ultimately, good things come out of that. So that even though I'm stung because of the world I live in, when His Spirit prays for me, I can overcome the sting. We go to Israel every year, and we took a group again this year just a few months ago. And there's a couple that had married kind of secularly, and I buried 2 years ago their 4.5-year-old daughter who drowned at Disney World. And when you go through that, you can imagine the personal blame, the hurt, the difficulty. And most of the time, when couples go through that, they divorce. But we sat in Golgotha, a group, and renewed their wedding vows because the power of the Holy Spirit praying in their life renewed who they were together in Christ. And what the enemy would have done by breaking them up, he lost because of the beauty and the prayer of the Holy Spirit. So I am made alive because all the things I lost because of my sin have been given back to me in the mercy and the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. I say, well, how did I get those? Well, by grace you're saved. He's already said in chapter 1, verse 7, that the blood of Jesus is our forgiveness, so I have this great grace from God. I don't do anything earn it. I don't get it because I go to church. I get it because it gives it to me. What's the end result? Look at this. He's raised me, sat me in the heavenlies in Christ Jesus, that He might show forth in the coming ages the superabundant riches of His grace and goodness upon us in Christ Jesus. From the moment you meet Christ, throughout eternity, you show off the grace and the goodness of Jesus Christ. That is a staggering statement. So here's what we have. I'm broken, my fault. I'm controlled by my culture, which is controlled by Satan, and I've got the wrath of God. But God has a whole different viewpoint. God, in His mercy, wipes away my sin in the blood of Jesus Christ. He restores me, He makes me alive, and He makes me a demonstration for eternity of exactly who and what He is. And preaching, they tell you to find the central idea of the text. Well, here's the central idea of the text. When you finish that, and you can't know this central idea unless you go through the whole passage. But here's the central idea. You put yourself in trouble, but God gets you out. That is the grace of Christ.